Of La Penta. It's WICR.
Hello, Iona College. Welcome back to the sports wall. Jersey Joe and Big Shot Rob rolling along. Just did a big chunk of our time slot on the NFL. A great week 10, but it has been an even better college football weekend. Saturdays have been better than Sundays from my point of view, and I could not wait to get back on the air. Now, I've got a little frustration, Rob. I'm not going to lie. The Auburn Tigers crushing my dreams. For people who don't know, I'm a huge Auburn Tigers fan. Auburn and Oregon are my two programs, and they just crushed my dreams. Now, Rob, let me start off with this. If I told you that the week before they played Texas A&M, Texas A&M beat, I can't even remember what the name of it was, UL Monroe, 21-16. Now, that doesn't sound right to struggle that much. Kyle Allen was 13 for 28. 106 yards, one touchdown, and one interception in that game. And in this game against Auburn, he was unstoppable. 277 yards, four touchdowns, and one interception. Auburn had no answer for him. The secondary mistakes, they could not clean things up. He just had a field day against him. And just Auburn being at home and losing this game, I have no words for how surprised I was that Auburn lost. I really don't.
Joe, this is like the most surprising loss. You look at this Texas A&M team, they're very weak this year. Suspension with Kenny Hill kills them. Their backup quarterback's not too great. This is a win where Auburn goes, we have to win this because we have to stay in the race for that playoff. And you just collapse. You give up 35 points to Texas A&M in the first half. That's what really killed them in this game, the 35 points. Otherwise, the second half, they held them to 6 points, played a great game in the second half.
They did.
But you can't work up magic once you give a team such a huge lead in the first half. And that's what Auburn failed to do. This is the when you look back at this schedule, this is the win that you need to get into that playoff. And this win just killed them big time.
It did. I mean, the rest of the way, it wasn't going to get any easier. You have Georgia this week. You have a game against Alabama rivalry week. It wasn't going to get easier. You would think that this was going to be a win that Auburn had in the bag, again, especially the way they played against UL Monroe. But I was really shocked and disappointed. I mean, Auburn ran the ball over 200 yards with Cameron Artis Payne. Nick Marshall made the plays, but too many mistakes from them. You had the turnovers at the end of the game. Both of them just killers. The exchange with Nick Marshall in the center. They fumbled that snap. There too many mistakes. Somebody said the miracles ran out for Auburn, and I guess in a way that's true. But I mean, it's more of just mistakes from the secondary of that team really struggling the last 2 weeks. But the thing I like about Auburn, Rob, is didn't make any excuses. They owned up to it. They admitted they just didn't show up in this game. They failed. Too many mistakes, and they just blew it in this one. And I like that accountability for this game. It's a game Auburn should not have lost. But you go on. They're one of the bigger surprises. The biggest game of the week. I mean, this is always one of my favorites. Alabama and LSU is always just such a good matchup. I was listening to the Colin Cowherd before. The ratings came in. It was a very good game, rated game. I believe the ratings were somewhere in the 5 range. For a Saturday, which is usually not a very good TV night, that's excellent. This has been such a good matchup over the years. But Alabama pulling away with the win in overtime, 20-13. Now, just Alabama and LSU, it was a battle of attrition. It really was. Both defenses were outstanding in this game. Both offenses could not really move the ball. But I have to say this, Rob. I mean, we're always honesty brokers on this show. Anthony Jennings for LSU is horrible. He's terrible. He really stinks. If LSU had a somewhat formidable quarterback, they would be one of the top 5 teams in the country.
Oh, they most definitely would, Joe. And that's the problem with LSU. With Les Miles, in his era, I've seen so much where his team is so great, his defense is so great, he never finds the proper quarterback to fit to his system. And that's one thing Alabama took advantage of. If a team doesn't have a quarterback, you got to take advantage and attack them hard. And that's what Alabama did in winning this game.
You are 150,000,000% correct. I was talking about this with my dad. I was saying, I haven't seen a formidable quarterback at LSU since Matt Flynn. Since Matt Flynn, I mean, you look at that when they had Jefferson, he was horrible. He's just a one-trick pony, run the ball, couldn't throw. You see this guy Jennings, he's atrocious. I mean, I'll read you the numbers from the game. He was 8 of 26 for 76 yards and one touchdown and one interception. He's really bad. I mean, LSU has an excellent run game. Leonard Fournette is just a beast. You look at them defensively, they're spectacular. But you give Blake Sims a lot of credit because that LSU defense gave him a ton of problems. But in the fourth quarter of that game, he led them to that drive to kick the field goal and tie it. You give him big props for that because he was really having a lot of trouble in this game. They couldn't really run the ball well. T.J. Yeldon had that fumble, but Alabama, when they needed that big drive from Blake Sims, he delivered. And at the end of the day, I knew LSU, at the second this game went to overtime, was at the disadvantage because Anthony Jennings, this was going to come down to who can get the ball in the end zone. And with Anthony Jennings, when you take the run game away from him, he's just not going to be able to get it done. So it's disappointing for LSU because they really played a phenomenal game. It was a battle. It really was. Now, Alabama plays Mississippi State. So, Rob, I'm going to you. Huge game this weekend for Alabama. They are home for this one. Who do you like between Mississippi State and Alabama?
I'm going with Alabama in this one. I think Saban's team is just on a roll right now, and nobody's stopping these boys right now. Mississippi State, don't get me wrong, they're a spectacular team. They're a great team, but you know what? They struggled the last couple weeks. They've had a hard time getting their wins. They've won them, but I think Alabama's going to give them a run for their money, and they're going to win this one. Nobody's able to shut down Amari Cooper right now for Alabama. If you can't shut him down, you have a lot to watch out for. And just the way this defense has been playing for Bama, this team's winning it this week.
I've had such a hard time. I'm going back and forth in my head between this game. The big thing I'm looking at here is you look at Alabama defensively, and they're spectacular. The second defense ranked in the country in points against. But you look at them, and I don't think they faced a lot of quarterbacks like Dak Prescott. Now, Dak Prescott's gone so much better in the passing game. Last year, he was really just a guy who just pulled it down and ran with it. Didn't really throw the ball very effectively. That has been a big improvement in his game this year. So you're looking at a guy who's very versatile offensively. So it's going to be interesting there. I do like Alabama in this game. I think Alabama will win because they are home. But you look at Alabama the rest of the way. They play Mississippi State. They play Western Carolina after that. And they play Auburn. Now, the big thing for all three of these games is they're all at home. Very favorable for Alabama. Being home for these last three games, two of them very tough, is very interesting because if Alabama can win all three, being home, you got to give them a little bit of an edge. Now, I don't think they will. I think they'll lose to Auburn the final week, but I'm with you, Rob. I think they do beat Mississippi State. Let's go on to the next big one, the Oregon Ducks in Utah. Utah is a very good football team. Gave Oregon problems in this game. They really did. Now, but Rob, you had a very interesting fact about the Oregon Ducks. Before I say what I have to say, I want you to get into that.
This year, Joe, Marcus Mariota is carrying this Oregon Ducks team, and I have to say one thing. He's carrying everything because his offensive line does not protect him. In all his 3 years, he's been sacked the most this year, 23 times. His other years, he's been sacked 18 or 17. This is 23 times, and he still has three more games to go. But Marcus Mariota, Joe, it's the Marcus Mariota show in Oregon.
It is.
This guy, week in and week out, carries this team. And I really hope if the Jets have a high pick this year, I hope they really look at him and scout him good because I'm very impressed with this kid.
I'm telling you, he has been unbelievable this year. I mean, you look at them, they're holding their offensive line together with duct tape. You just mentioned the sacks. I mean, he is just being pressured time and time again. Really, the offensive line, there were some sacks they gave up in that game where it was just not even funny. I mean, they're just the holes in that just opened up. People were not going to their assignments. The offensive line is just not very good. But Marcus Mariota, I mean, the big thing you look at them is with some of the performances, especially Oregon defensively is not that good this year. Their offensive line struggles. But Marcus Mariota finds ways to win these games big. And even in this game, I mean, the score is 51-27. You would think from that score that Oregon dominated every second of this game, but it really wasn't. I mean, the beginning, the first quarter there, Utah's up 7-0. Oregon really starts to get into the rhythm in the second quarter, 24-3. They outscore them. But then again, in the third quarter, Utah gets more momentum, but Marcus Mariota comes back in the fourth quarter. I just think I've been so impressed with him this year because he really has a lot of things to deal with. A lot of setbacks. Defensively, they're not good. The offensive line is so important, but Marcus Mariota keeps finding a way to win. You look at Oregon the rest of the way. They have a bye this week. After that, they play Colorado. And then they finish off against Oregon State. Now, Oregon State's a rivalry game. Always interesting there. But I think Oregon, the Oregon Ducks, will finish as one of the top four teams. And, Rob, it's something we always want to see.
Oh, it definitely is, Joe. I want to see him come time for the playoffs because I think he's going to give a lot of battles versus other teams. I don't know if Oregon's going to win or even win a BCS championship just because of how the rest of the team is around
him. You. I don't think they can win it just because defensively, if they play another team, they just won't be able to stop them. If they played one of these bigger physical SEC teams, I just think that offensive line would not stand a chance. Marcus Mariota would just be on the ground too much. But you never know, and that's why you play the games. It will be exciting regardless. Though, let's go on. I mean, the nighttime games were just, you can't even joke about it. You had TCU West Virginia, LSU Alabama, and then Ohio State, Michigan State. Now, Rob, I made the prediction. I was on the Ohio State bandwagon. Everybody was picking Michigan State to win this game, but I watched these two teams very closely the last couple of weeks. I just looked at Michigan State, and I was not very impressed. A lot of games where they just didn't show me a lot. Defensively, they were definitely not as good as they were last year. Offensively, Cook played well, but Michigan State just didn't scare me. Ohio State was terrified me because you look at the way they'd been playing since that Virginia Tech game. They had five straight games with over 500 yards of total offense. JT Barrett, I can't say enough about how good this kid is. This kid is unbelievable. His progression with Urban Meyer has been fantastic. This kid does things that even Braxton Miller can't do. He's throwing the ball better now as a passer than Braxton Miller has done his whole career there. It makes an interesting debate because we all know Braxton Miller being hurt this year, planning to come back next year. But I'm going to be honest, I'm closing the books on Braxton Miller. This kid, JT Barrett's the real deal. He was in full command of the offense. Michigan State had no answer for JT Barrett. I mean, excellent play calling from Ohio State. He was just so good. I mean, running the ball, throwing the ball. It was a phenomenal performance from Ohio State, and I thought all along they are the hands down, it's not even close, the best team in the Big Ten.
Oh, they most definitely are, Joe. And going back to JT Barrett, Joe, we look at earlier in the season when Braxton Miller went down with that injury, everybody said Ohio State, their program's done. They're not even going to be ranked this year. JT Barrett has stepped it up, five touchdowns over the last 2 weeks, really has led this team. And my question to you, Joe, is, do you see him as a Heisman candidate?
That is interesting, Rob. I wanted to talk about that. I mean, I legitimately do. I mean, here's the thing. The first two games for him were very difficult, but I think you've got to look at the circumstances. This is a guy who we were not expecting to even see. We wouldn't have even have known his name if it wasn't for the injury to Braxton Miller. To come in and do what he's done has been just remarkable. It really has. The guy has been fantastic. I mean, he's definitely in the conversation for me. For me, it's pretty much Marcus Mariota, Dak Prescott, Melvin Gordon from Wisconsin. And then after that, I think JT Barrett is as good a chance as anybody. And I want to ask you this, though. When Braxton Miller comes back next year, what do you do? I mean, you got to give him some respect, but JT Barrett is going to be so good.
I say you stay with JT Barrett.
You do.
You stay with the quarterback that is hot at the moment. We see it in the NFL. If you get injured and your backup's playing hot, your backup is going to start for you. The coach goes with who's going to give you the most firepower, who's going to get you done, who's going to get you that W. And I think right now you got to just stick with JT Barrett. The kid is on fire. Do not bench him whatsoever. Even going into next year, do not bench him. Do not hurt his confidence. Keep him where he is right now.
I'm 100% on board. You look at what he's done this young in his career. This is his first year he never expected to play. Think how good he is now and how much better he can be. Ohio State could legitimately be one of the top four playoff teams for the next three years. They really can. Mm-hmm. JT Barrett is unbelievable. I'm a big fan of the Buckeyes right now. I think the rest of the way for Ohio State, they will win out. I really do. I mean, they play Indiana, Minnesota, and Michigan. All three of those programs, okay. Michigan's a disaster. They should easily win all those games. They get Michigan at home, which helps them out even more. And if things pan out the way they look like they are, Nebraska and Wisconsin do play this week. That'll be Nebraska's tough test. But if things work out, it'll be Ohio State and Nebraska in the Big Ten championship game. There is no question in my mind, Ohio State is clearly a better team than Nebraska is. You take away Amir Abdullah out of the equation. Nebraska is a team that doesn't throw the football very well. I think Ohio State is going to win out with the one loss. So, Rob, what's going to happen? I mean, there's going to be so many moving parts the last couple weeks. But if Ohio State wins out, do they deserve a chance to be one of the top four playoff teams?
I think so.
Yeah.
I really do, because this team has really held it strong. Through all the loss of their quarterback at the start of the year, really held it in strong this season. And I think if they win this division, if they win the Big Ten, I think you really have to consider them a playoff team.
I'm with you. Now, the other big one this weekend, TCU and Kansas State, the battle of the Big 12, probably the best two teams in the Big 12. I think they're both better than Baylor, to be quite honest. Even though Baylor beat TCU, I still think TCU is a better team than they are. TCU winning, though, 41-20. Trevon Boykin really taking charge in this game. I mean, I thought the big part of this game was going to be Trevon Boykin's athleticism, him over Jake Waters. Jake Waters is the quarterback for Kansas State. I thought Trevon Boykin's athleticism would be enough to get through this game. It was. TCU wins this game, and TCU is pretty much going to win out. Now, the Big 12 does not have a championship game, so pretty much TCU was set. They're only going to lose the one game. They have games coming up against Kansas, Iowa State, and Texas. Now, none of those teams are real threats. TCU will win out. But, Rob, is it fair? I mean, you look at a team like Mississippi State or Alabama, they're still going to most likely have to play in the SEC championship. You look at a team like Ohio State and a team like Arizona State or Oregon, they will most likely have to play in their championships of their conferences. But TCU will not. Is that fair?
I don't think it's fair. You know, a lot of people say to me, oh, well, that's the way it's set. Well, when I look at it, I think it should be for the playoffs, how competitive the team is. I don't think it should go by, they deserve to make it because this team lost. If Mississippi State and Alabama play, I think they should still both be allowed to be in the playoff because those teams are the two top competitive teams that you want to see. I don't want to see TCU make it just because they didn't have to play in a tough game, first of all, in the championship week. It's ridiculous in my eyes.
I'm 100% on board with you. I think that's very fair. Now, the final game I want to go over is Notre Dame and Arizona State. Arizona State just shutting down Notre Dame 55-31. Now, it got a little interesting towards the end, but overall, Arizona State just pulled away, and it was all turnovers. I mean, Everett Golson, the big knock on him has been he is so turnover prone, and it's a fair criticism. I mean, the guy has got so much talent. He came into the season as a much better college football player. He throws the ball better. He's a very dynamic offensive talent, but his problem has been turnovers, fumbles, interceptions. It was just horrendous in this game. The big thing, I thought Notre Dame was starting to get momentum when the third quarter opened up. He brought them right down the field, a trip to the red zone, and he throws a red zone interception. That sums up the game for Notre Dame. Everett Golson, they kept getting a little close, and then just turnovers shut it down for Notre Dame. Notre Dame, I think, now fairly is pretty much out of the conversation at 7-2. I mean, the two losses they have to Florida State, Arizona State, they still go to at USC, which will be interesting, but I think Notre Dame, for the most part, is pretty much out of the conversation. Now, you look at Arizona State. Arizona State is a very good football team. Todd Graham has got a good thing going there, but their schedule the rest of the way is pretty tough as well. I mean, look at them. There's a legit chance that they lose another game. Arizona State plays at Oregon State next week, Washington State, and at Arizona. Those are two very tough road Pac-12 games. I don't think they win both those games. I think they lose one of them. So Arizona State, interesting there. Definitely keep an eye on. But I wanted to go over, obviously, the College Playoff Committee will come out with their new results tomorrow on Tuesday. They always do. But the AP Top 25, if it's anything like it, going over the top 10, I really don't have much of a problem with it except for one team. No, let's go to 1 through 10. You have number 1, Mississippi State, Florida State, Oregon, and Alabama. That makes up the top 4 for the top 25. I have no problem with that. I think that's what the committee is going to come out with as their top four. Rob, what about you?
Yeah, I think that's fair to say, Joe. You know my feelings with Florida State and all, but yep. They're still undefeated. They're going to remain at two. Mississippi's still undefeated. They're going to stay at one. And I think Oregon and Alabama still stay in their position.
100% agree. And then you have number five, TCU, number six, Baylor, number seven, Arizona State, number eight, Ohio State, and number nine, Auburn. Now, here's the one thing I have a problem with is Baylor being at six. Why is Baylor at six over Arizona State and Ohio State? Now, Baylor is a good team, don't no disrespect to them, but their schedules have been nowhere near as impressive with wins as Ohio State and Arizona State have been. I mean, there's no way that Baylor should be ahead of Arizona State and Ohio State right now. I would definitely push them back to the eighth spot, move Arizona State up to six, and move Ohio State up to seven, but it's very interesting. And the final note on college football I want to say, though, is Rob, Florida State, if it wasn't for them not losing a game in 2 years now, would they even be in your top four?
No.
I'm with you. I'm with you.
I don't like the competitiveness. I feel Jameis Winston is not the same guy he was last year. He built too much controversy around himself, got himself involved with too many stuff outside of football. And that's really what's killing this team right now. Winston has too much on his mind. This Seminole team is not the same team we saw last year. The Seminole team that purely dominated last year. This team, we look at this week, Joe, they win 34-20 versus Virginia, and I would expect them to blow out Virginia more. I know it's a rivalry game. But I expect more out of Florida State. Winston throws one touchdown, two interceptions. And when it comes to playoffs, this team is getting knocked out right away. I'm telling you right now, this is a team that will be knocked out in the first round.
I'm 100% with you. If it wasn't for them, I mean, you can't take them down purely because if for a team to not lose a game in two seasons like this, it's very hard to do. But it's just been about, are you impressing me? And they have not. It is very dangerous. They're playing a very dangerous game right now because there hasn't been really one dominant performance from Florida State all year. All year, and the ACC is definitely down, which doesn't help their cause. It'd be one thing if the ACC was extremely competitive, but it is not. Florida State has got a lot of question marks. I'm 100% on board with you, Rob. If they played an SEC team in the playoff tomorrow, it would be just dismantling. They would not stand a chance. But that is why we are waiting for the playoff committee. Rob and I are pretty much agreed on our top four. A lot of good college football thoughts. When we come back with the last 10 minutes we have, we're talking a little NBA. So when we come back, stay with us, and we will be right back.
WICR presents another great...